Well, listen to this. You know you're in trouble. My wife sent me a text, and the text reads like this. Did okay. you know that for every 25 pounds a man loses, he gains an inch in his penis?
Oh, geez, Louise.
And what I said, I immediately wrote back, are you trying to tell me something? And this was Tuesday.
Wow. I don't even know where to take that, Brad. I guess I have to stop getting ice cream. All right. Well, that's fine. Fair enough.
Believe me, it was much more fun when we were talking about noodling. Holy cats, where did
25 pounds. I guess the idea there is cantilevering. You know what? I'm not going to go into the physics of this. I'm not.
She said there's scientific research to prove this.
Wow. This is amazing that it came from your wife.
And she was willing to send me links to the scientific research.
Oh, for God's sake. She put some thought into this, Brad.
Holy cats.
Oh, this is me putting my hand on your shoulder and saying, brother, it's time for you to go on a diet.
Clearly.
The missus is sending you some signs, my
man. It ain't easy, telling you.
Oh, boy. All right, well, that's one of those topics that you brought that up, and immediately my cheeks went red. I was like, oh.
I love doing that to you. That may be my favorite part of the show, is making you embarrassed.
I still have that choir boy aspect. I'm like, oh boy. All right, I guess we're talking about this.
Should we be talking about this?
I know. I'm like looking around my empty studio going, I don't know.
Well, do you want to do a different cold open?
No, I don't.
Oh, because I've got one on how she doesn't like the moves I make in bed either.
Oh God. All right. Well, on that note, hi, everybody. And welcome to Comic Lab, the show about making comics.
And making a living from comics. I'm Brad Guigar, editor of webcomics.com and cartoonist of Evil Inc.
And I'm Dave Kellett, cartoonist of Drive, and Sheldon, and the co-director of Strip.
And this week's Hour of Comics Advice is made possible by your support at patreon.com/comiclab.
Brad, I have good news for you, my friend, to start off the week.
Yes.
We are at 69 five-star ratings on iTunes to get towards Drunk Comic Lab.
Wow.
69.
I ain't touching it.
My cheeks go red again.
As it is. Yeah, we are very, very close to Drunk Comic Lab. You guys have really responded to this. I'm kind of amazed.
Well, and I have to tell you, for those that did not notice it, I realized that iTunes does not make it easy. We are asking you guys to do something, and Apple's like, no, we're not going to let you do it. So I put together a very quick visual on patreon.com/comiclab. It's going to be in the last post or two, and it just shows you how on your phone, within 30 seconds, I guarantee it, you can give Comic Lab a five-star rating. So if you would, if you're kind enough, if your heart is full, if you're a good person, if you like going through the world and making it a better place, then go give a quick five-star rating to Comic Lab using the instructions that I put up on Patreon.
Absolutely. And as soon as we get to 100, Dave and I both uncork a bottle of our favorite tasty adult beverage, fire up the mics, and just start talking with no real agenda.
I'm going to change my drink to from Pinot Noir to Mojito. That is what I'm going to be having.
A tasty little Mojito.
I'm more delightful on a Mojito than I am in wine. So you're gonna like the Mojito, Dave.
That's great. That sounds fantastic. Now, are you in favor of a more sweeter Mojito, or is it, because last time I had a Mojito at a restaurant, we were at a place called Cuba Libre. And the Mojito was very, very sweet. Is this normal, or is this how do you like your Mojitos?
Well, having married into a family of Cubans, I got to tell you, if you went to a Cuban restaurant and got a Mojito, they may have made your Mojito with pure sugar cane, and that is amazing.
Oh, really?
It tastes fantastic. It's like a punch in the mouth of sugar. It's delightful. But so my philosophy on drinks is, because people make fun of me when I go to Mexican restaurants, but I am like a 9-year-old girl when it comes to drinks. The more I can make a drink look like basically a living My Little Pony character, I want a strawberry margarita that literally there's a guy, as I'm sipping it, he's still dumping sugar into the strawberry margarita. Like he's got the 20-pound bag and he's like, Señor, and he's dumping it into my margarita as I'm drinking it. That's what I want out of a drink.
Oh, that's too sweet for me. I like a whiskey sour, but I actually like that to be a little bit more tart than sweet. I'm not crazy about the sweet alcoholic beverages. And doesn't that gives you a worse headache in the morning, all that sugar?
No, Brad, no. My body responds very well to sugar.
Nothing.
And gets very angry if you try to give me something like a sharp drink. Like I remember you and I, where were we? Was it Calgary Comic Con many years ago? You and I were sitting at a bar after the show.
Oh my God.
And you had ordered a really fancy whiskey sour and I was drinking, let's just say, a milkshake with some booze in it. I don't know what I was thinking.
Kahlua and milkshake.
Yeah, exactly. And you were like, hey, try this. I want to introduce you to a new drink. And I went from my sugary sweetness to your sharp, smoky whiskey. Yeah. And I think I just about spat out the drink. It was a big change from what I'm used to.
I remember that because weren't there a bunch of voice actors at the other side of the bar? I'm having a cloudy remembrance of this.
Yes. Yes. I have a vague memory of that as well. Yes, there were. Why do we remember that? There were a bunch of voice actors at the bar.
Ever since, I've been trying to remember if those were Dragon Ball Z voice actors because, you know, my kids are now huge into DBZ and I'd love to tell them stories about hanging out vicariously through these through the bar, but I cannot remember who they were. I was hoping you could.
I gotta stop you. Hold on. Did you say DBZ? Was that what
Dragon
you said?
Dragon Ball Z.
Oh, for God's sake! It's called DBZ among the youths. Oh, jeez.
DBZ.
Oh man. Hey, Pop. Can I watch some DBZ? What's up? I'm gonna go skateboarding and then watch some DBZ.
Yeah, that's what we call it around the house, DBZ.
Oh my God, DBZ. Oh boy. Anyway, so my drink of choice is basically if you could take a living embodiment of strawberry shortcake or Applejack from My Little Pony and make that into a drink, that's what Dave Kellett wants. God. I just want sugar.
Really?
I want 90% sugar, 10% alcohol. That's what I want.
Wow. Yeah, we are different. We are different on that score.
Anyway, we just need 31 using my math. Yes, that's right. 31 more people to do 5-star ratings on iTunes, and the Drunk Comic Lab is yours. It's all
yours. We're getting there, man. It's going to be a lot of fun. And thank you for backing us on that. I was amazed at how quickly that rose. So thank you for jumping in on that. We're amazed.
Here's where you and I differ. You're amazed by how quickly people are jumping in on it. I'm a little grumpy about it. I'm like, there are thousands of people listening to the show and only 69 of you? Come on.
Well, that's true.
I know people can do better.
You guys need to step it up a little bit.
Listen, I know too many cartoonists to know that some people are literally sitting at their desk with their pencil in their hand with their other finger in their navel and not clicking over to do a 5-star rating. When it takes mere seconds of your life.
So listen, Dave, we've got a bunch of questions that are from our $5 level Patreon backers. And part of their reward is they get to write us a question every month. And it's kind of like a little mini consultation. It's like, what do you want us to talk about?
I love it. The questions so far have been great, by the way, from those backers. Yeah. So thank you.
And I've got three good ones sitting here. So what do you say we knock them off just one after another?
Not only do I want to knock it off, I want you to snap every time we have new questions. That was great.
Well, here's the first one. What is the most popular gift or perk you can give to a Patreon backer? Is it free stuff? Is it early access? What's the best thing you can give as rewards on your Patreon? So let's talk Patreon rewards.
Well, now, normally I would jump in with my answer right after you've asked the question, but you just went to the very special Patreon open house, which they held in New York City. And by the way, they have ones coming up in, they just did LA, they did New York, and they have it coming up in Chicago, Austin, and Seattle. So if you're in one of those three cities, go to them. But Bradley J. Geiger just went to the one in New York. So I will actually turn the question back around to you, Brad, because I feel like you're going to be our resident specialist. What do you feel like from the stats that Patreon gave you? Are the best rewards.
This was really interesting. Of course, now what they're taking a look at is from the top down. They're looking at everybody across the entire swath of Patreon. And they had some great statistics. All night they were pumping out really great statistics on Patreon. So the first one, no surprise to anybody that's listened to this podcast, because this is something we've been talking about for a long time. 36% of readers said that they most value exclusive content. In other words, something that you're giving to your Patreon backers that nobody else can get. It goes back to that same old thing. People want something for their money. And it also, very interestingly, it kind of shows how, even though Patreon very much started out as a tip jar situation, it is now overwhelmingly a vehicle for exclusive content, for subscription membership. And the best thing you can do, give them something they can't get anyplace else. 36%. And this one, they actually had a couple of differing opinions on, but the next one up on the list is early access. In other words, for ComicLab, our ComicLab backers get the episodes usually about 24, 48 hours before they go out to the public. So they get an early jump on getting each episode of ComicLab. 17% of Patreon patrons said that they valued that. 13% said physical rewards. Now, I'm going to put my own little asterisk on that and give you a caveat. Beware of physical rewards, because you can really get in trouble with that stuff. Number one, shipping adds up very, very quickly. And if you're not careful, you can give back all the money that you earned on Patreon. You can give it back in shipping. And number two, I see a lot of people making this mistake. They say, if you're my Patreon backer, I'll send you a copy of XYZ book. But that's a one-time reward. And what you're trying to do is get somebody to give you monthly money. If you want somebody to give you money every month, you've got to reward them every month. So if you're giving them a one-time reward on what you want to be a multiple payment, you better be prepared to ship out physical things every month, or else you're going to lose that patron. They're going to go away when they realize, I got my book and I'm still paying. What am I getting for this backing? So be very careful with physical rewards. You can really shoot yourself in the foot. But that was 13.4%. One that really surprised me, polls. 9.9% of them say they value Patreon polls, the little polls that you set up with Patreon. And you can check out the pro tips. We go into that in a little bit of detail for our Patreon backers. Going down the list even further, here's one, Dave, that you would have never thought even gets as high as it does. Recognition. And this, I'm sure, is like YouTubers and podcasts, but there's applications for guys like us. Recognition, shout outs. Hey, thank you very much to Patreon backer Jake Smith, who is our patron of the month or the Patreon of the moment, or you just mentioned this person in a tweet, or thank you, Patreon backer Mary Sue. Here's looking at you, Mary Sue. Little bit of recognition goes a long way. They like being recognized. Okay. And then I'll just knock these off real quick. Live stream, 4.2%. No reward, 2.1%. And questions and answers, or access to your inbox, in other words, where they can go back and forth with you on a personal level, 1.4%.
Really? That's 1.4%. I would have thought that would have been higher. Huh. I am far overvaluing how delightful I am to interact with.
I didn't think that could be possible. Yeah, that is not as great, even as a poll where they're taking part in like a communal thing. Polls are much more powerful than I would have even considered giving them credit for.
Well, you very deftly go through polls in the Pro Tips episode, so we don't need to go into that. But it's fascinating to see those numbers broken down. And so to our $5 patron who asked this question, what's great about the answers that Brad just gave you is that those are quantifiable. Those are from Patreon themselves. And so it's worth having a look at your own pre-assumptions of what would work and what would not work, and myself included there, because I thought the interactivity was a great bonus. By not answering comments on my main Drive site, but answering it on Drive, Patreon, I had always assumed, oh, this is a great benefit. They're interacting, asking direct questions, getting direct answers, getting back behind the scenes and spins on things. Turns out, they'd much rather have more exclusive drawings and sketches. So maybe I need to start doing that.
I've got a thought on that.
Sure. Give it to me. Yes, yes, yes.
Law of diminishing returns. In other words, if I want to have a back and forth with Dave Kellett, I could write him an email from his site. I could hit, or if I don't have his email, I can hit the contact button on his website. I can grab him on Twitter. I can get him on Facebook. I can get you on Instagram. There's about half a dozen, to depending on who you are, a dozen ways that you can get in touch with the creator of your choice. That's kind of what we built webcomics on, interactivity. In other words, we looked at those syndicated cartoonists. We're like, geez, if you want to send Burke Breath a note or talk to him about Opus, you really can't. But web cartoonists always made ourselves very, very available. I don't think that it's a question of they don't value that. It's that it's so easily available that it devalues itself because of the sheer volume of it. What do you think about that?
So you're saying that I am cheap and easy when it comes to your contact.
Yes, I've been saying that for years. Cheap and easy Dave Kellett is what we call him around the office.
No, around the office. I like that around the office is you and a transformer that you have on your desk.
Absolutely. No, but I really do think that's the case. I don't have to go to Patreon if I want to have a conversation with you. I can hit Twitter. And I know you're going to respond to me because you're a nice guy.
Well, so then this raises the question. So why do you think, and I know you already talked about this on the Pro Tips episode, but why do you think polls are, is it because you are affecting the outcome of the strip and the story and the products themselves?
Well, there's a whole bunch of different types of polls. You know, you can do that type of poll where you say, I want you to, in fact, I see people doing this all the time. I'm going to draw something tomorrow. You guys choose what I'm going to draw. Is it going to be this, this, or this? Or, you know, choose which way the strip goes. You know, should this person come in or should I do this other thing? You can build in a certain level of interactivity to that. Or you could just say, hey, I just went to see Black Panther. Thumbs up or thumbs down? Or it can be a totally silly thing. So I don't know that they're getting the type of access that you're describing. I just think that they enjoy taking polls. I think it's a very basic this is a fun thing to do.
So on some level, it's a look at me, mom, clicking things kind of thing.
Well, it's that easy return. Again, like we see in all polls, you immediately find out whether you're with the majority or the minority. And there's something that's compelling about either one of those situations.
Well, and so because I know it's going to be a lot on a lot of people's minds out there as they listen to this. The answer is yes, I'm a Miranda. and so that's where I land on Sex in the City. I took the poll before we started the show. And I kind of suspected that I was a Miranda, but it turns out I am a Miranda.
I am so a Charlotte.
And a Charlotte? Did you say Charlotte?
I don't know why that happened.
When did you become a Puerto Rican grandmother? Hello, have you met Charlotte? That was amazing. What was that? What was
no
that
idea
weird accent
that
you
happened.
Put on Charlotte? That was amazing. I gotta say, as a DBZ van myself, Brad, I'm the DBZ that I'm most like is the guy with the orange hair.
Which
the
one?
Guy that I'm most like. I literally never watched Dragon Ball Z. I don't know anything about it.
Wait till that son of yours gets a little bit older, and you'll learn all about DBZ.
So, is Dragon Ball Z the one where like literally the superhero is unbeatable? Like it's like why is anyone even fighting him? It's like Superman
but it is bizarre because I really question my kid's sanity. Because for you can watch a half an hour show and it's worse than a soap opera in terms of pacing. And what I mean by that is it usually takes place out in a desert because I guess maybe those backgrounds are easy to draw. But there's two people, they face off in a desert and then they taunt each other and talk back and forth for like 25 minutes out of a 30-minute episode. And then they fight and then it's over. And then the next episode is exactly the same. They just float over top of a desert and taunt back and forth. And then there's a little bit of action. And I'm looking at my kids like, what could you possibly gain out of this? It's not particularly like it's not like a roast or it's not like very creative taunting where you go like, oh, man, that was a sick burn or something. It's just I'm better than you. Oh no, I'm much better than you. Well, I know you think that you're better than me, but I'm actually better than you. And it goes on like it's so dumb.
You're really selling this, Brad. It's amazing. This sounds like the worst show I've ever heard. Oh, God. You know what it sounds like? It sounds like, and this must be exactly what they're mirroring. It sounds like two 11-year-old boys on a playground.
Yeah. Oh, my God.
It's like 20 minutes of we're going to fight and then 30 seconds of us actually fighting. Yeah. And then a teacher comes in and separates us.
And that's exactly what it is. It's exactly what it is. And the ones that, like, I would see them, they like, yeah, and this is the edited version. The unedited version, these conversations go for much longer. And I'm like, but you like, guys so, are so nuts.
Here's granted, I've had the most passing interaction with Dragon Ball Z. I've seen like a couple visuals of it. But the main dude, what's his name again? The main dude?
Goku.
Goku, right. Sure, of course. Goku's the dude with the hair, right?
Yep. Yeah. Well, listen, they've okay. all got hair to very... There's a whole thing where you become a Super Saiyan, your hair turns gold and gets spiky. And then if you evolve even further, I think you get a tail, like a monkey tail, but there's,
sure.
there's a whole, but yeah, he's the one with the spiky blonde hair.
All right, sure. So, and he also loses his sleeves in the process, doesn't he? Isn't
always,
that what happens?
Always, yeah. You got to see the guns. Yeah,
they all become Sylvester Stallone in an early 90s movie. Got it. So here's my question to you. So Goku becomes, what did you say it was, a Super Saiyan man?
Super Saiyan.
Super Saiyan. He becomes a Super Saiyan. But then isn't the basic idea that he is literally unbeatable?
Yes.
So why is there even a show? Like, who cares?
Because maybe somebody's going to beat him even though he's unbeatable. And it's one of those things that if you really want to see my kids like truly pissed off, tell them that Superman could beat Goku, and then just sit back and listen to the barrage of very passionate discourse that goes on telling you just how wrong you are.
Okay, well, so Superman has kryptonite, and he has Lois, who can be held captive. So there's two ways to get a hold of Superman.
Right.
But what is Goku's, like, if you put sleeves on him, does he lose his power? If you comb his hair, does he lose his power? What happens?
He's just, again, it's like an 11-year-old boy envisioning a superhero. He's...
So it's just, it's pure power planet fantasy. There's no weaknesses at all for this dude?
None at all. He doesn't have a weakness that I'm aware of.
If you taunt him really well in a desert while he's floating, would that stop him?
If you get in one sick burn, you might... you might bring him down a peg or two. You might be able to, he might be crestfallen at that.
You know what we should do? We should, for Drunk Comic Lab, I should watch my first 5 minutes of Dragon Ball Z ever and just do a running commentary about what's happening. That would be amazing.
Oh, well, it'll sober you right up, I'll tell you that.
So he's got glam rock hair. Yeah. He's got sleeveless Sylvester Stallone outfits. He's not really good at doing sick burns, and he's immensely powerful. Yeah. So that's the version of DBZ.
Now you know everything you need to know about DBZ.
I'm preparing myself for about 8 years from now when I'm like, Brad, I'm watching DBZ. It is the worst.
Oh, man.
And cut to you in 8 years going, well, I'm paying for college, so fuck you.
And you know what he's doing in that dorm room? Watching fucking DBZ. Holy cat.
All right, so I think we nailed that first $5 question, my friend. Shall we move on to the next one?
Yeah, that sounds good to me. Oh, you know what? Let's come around to this because it does keep coming up. How do you balance keeping Patreon content exclusive while at the same time promoting content publicly to incentivize backers? It's something that we talked about in an earlier podcast, but let's just hit it really quick. And the answer to that is there's a bunch of ways that you can do this, and you should be eagerly trying to find ways to do this. But here's a couple that just come to mind. You have two different series. One of them is Patreon exclusive. One of them is public facing. And in fact, that's what I do with Evil Inc. and Evil Inc. After Dark. In fact, oftentimes the Evil Inc. storyline will get to a certain point, and I'll say, if you want to see what happens with the rest of this particular storyline, jump over to Evil Inc. After Dark. And it goes back and forth sometimes. Or you can just have one thing that you think is very much worth having Patreon backers make that exclusive, make the other thing public facing. And then how do you promote it? Well, yeah, crop it, talk about it. There's a bunch of ways you can promote it. This is where you should be putting your creative brain to work, is by trying to answer that question. How can I do that? But there's tons of ways. You do not have to give away your exclusive in order to promote it. All right. So I just wanted to hit that because that way I can click one more off my list here.
I was going to add to that. Brad's also spoken about this on an earlier show, but I think the idea is genius. You can also do exclusive swaps with another title.
Oh, yeah.
And Brad and has spoken about this, but the idea that you take 15 pages of Evil Ink, bundle it up into an ebook PDF. I take 15 pages of Drive ebook, bundle it up into a PDF. We swap, we give it to the other readers, and as a packaged good, it's an exclusive only to Patreon, and so it does exist publicly, but as a readable ebook, maybe it only goes out to Patreon. So that's
That's a great one. All right, next question: any tips for getting unstuck when you've been stuck on finding something to write about within your comic series? Dave, now, This is a good one for you, I think, because you do something that I find very difficult to do. And that is, with Sheldon, there's often not an ongoing storyline for you to draw from. In other words, you do what is very much close to what we think about in a standalone, like a single panel comic, even though it's often multi-panels. And I find that impossible or nearly impossible to do, because I need a little structure. I can't do a comic about anything. I got to do a comic about something, because I'm so busy running around with anything that I never get anything done. Does that make any sense?
Wow, that was an amazing phrase. That was fantastic.
How do you do it? I want to ask this question of you. How do you get unstuck when you're stuck?
Well, part of it is, as you know, it's like any skill. The more you do it, you get a little bit better at the tips and tricks of it. So for me, I read the question more of when I'm writing long form, when I'm writing Drive, and you know what maybe your step is the next act, but you don't know how to get from point A to point B. That's a particular problem that I suffer from a lot. But let me answer your question first. So how do I write short form, standalone, single shot Sheldons? The answer is, for me, that's actually easier writing, because a lot of that is I'm out at the mall, or I'm looking at a cat, or I'm talking to a friend, and any one of those three topics, you can go, oh, I have a joke about malls now. I have a joke about a cat. I have a joke about a friend. And you incorporate that as a single one shot. So for me, that is more slice of life. That's more observational. It's more kind of shower thoughts writing. Mm-hmm. And it's easier because you're in and you're out and you're done with that comic in a day. But as far as how to trigger those type of comics, what I can do is I will, as I've said before, I will go back and read through my own archives. Mm. And what that does is that just reminds me of my own comedic voice and style and tone and topics that maybe I explored 4 or 5 years ago that are like, oh, you know what? I have new thoughts on that, or I have an expanded thought on that, or I have a completely different take now that I'm older. So that's one way that I do it. Another way that I do it, and I can't recommend this enough, is just get out into the world. You will get, it's kind of like you make none of the shots that you don't take. If you don't get out into the world, you won't get those spark of ideas that exist only by interacting with the world. By looking at the same four walls in your studio, you will get the same four walls of ideas.
That's brilliant. By looking at the same four walls, you get the same four walls. I'm not making fun. That is really, that got through to me.
Oh, okay, good. Well, yeah. And another thing that I really appreciate as a writer is I will, every once in a while, Papa treats himself to a little pancake breakfast. He drops the kids off, but goes to get a little pancake breakfast, right?
Yeah.
But listen, Brad, Papa needs to eat better. I get it, right? But you've already made that point abundantly clear in terms of my sex life.
So do I.
So one benefit about going to a cafe, especially a tightly packed cafe, if you've ever been to Paris, those really tightly packed cafes are the ideal for this. But there are certain American cafes where you're a little bit tighter packed in, if it's a mom and pop cafe, than you would be at a chain. So when you're there and you're sitting by yourself, you can overhear the tidbits of conversation and the tonalities and the accents and the vocal approaches and the worldviews that wouldn't naturally occur to you. And those are great sources of comedy because, as you and I do, Brad, we hear a voice and we just start doing a voice and then all of a sudden all sorts of jokes start coming out. You know what I mean? Like,
yeah, so I know what you're talking about. It's like when I host The Tonight Show, every now and again, I'll just think, hey, that's a good accent to try every now and again. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I was transported to The Tonight Show. That was amazing. So yeah, so hearing other voices is a great idea for getting ideas. Reading is another source of idea. Find the author that you find funniest and that brings you the greatest joy. both because it will remind you of the sentence structures, the setups, and yes. the approaches to humor that they use, but also it just makes your heart happier. And when you yourself are laughing, then it's much easier to write comedy. You'll find joy in the tidbits of your own life. So that's it for short form. So where I find harder actually is when I get stuck writing long form. Mm. So for example, Drive is going to end up being, I don't know, an 800 page story or so. And I know what I need to get to for page 400. I know what I need to get to for page 300. But right now I'm on page 200 and I don't know what to write next. And that to me is the hardest roadblock that I face on a week to week basis is I know what I need to do 4 weeks from now. But do I do A or B right now? And so for that, I will ask you, Brad, how do you approach that?
Well, we talked about a little while ago about how I use like a sitcom writing technique to plan out my graphic novels. And that helps me an awful lot. Working from an outline, which is something that I hadn't done prior to 2016, really did help me kind of see all the connections and everything. You know, I know where everything's got to go. And once I have a plan, you can write to that plan. What I kind of always tell myself is it doesn't matter how you get there. It just matters that you get there. So if I've got a plot point, there's a million different ways that I can get from where that story was in the beginning and where that story has to be at that next plot point. That doesn't matter, but as long as I get there. So then I just start exploring all of the different ways of getting there with the idea of kind of pushing myself to finding the funniest one and not just accept the first one that comes along, but to say, okay, right. that's a good one. We'll call that insurance. Now let's see if we can push that or exaggerate it or take it to a weirder spot, something like that. That is what happens for me, and that's often when I find out that that first idea really wasn't all that great, but it took me to a better place. And that's, for me, that's half of writing, is not letting yourself off the hook.
Well, I was going to say, how often in your writing career do you get an idea and go, done, that was it, I'm not going back to the well, and how often do you go, I'm going to give one more pass?
It's impossible to answer the question that you've asked, I think, because I don't honestly know, because it's not like a one pass, two pass, three pass. Usually it's like a whole bowl of spaghetti on my page that I kind of edit down. So I don't know that I can give you a very good answer other than the fact that I do know that the times that my writing is the most solid is the times that I didn't stop at just the first one. I pushed it.
Well, that raises a question. So what are, and this is separate, but maybe related to the question that the patron asked. Mm-hmm. What are the best conditions for Brad Guigar to sit down and write?
Oh, empty house, quiet, door shut, noises off, completely hermited. I write really well in the studio and I write really well at the house when everybody is gone. I like being sequestered. And also, I'll be honest with you, access to a computer, because a lot of times, like you'll type a word into Google, for example, and the returns that brings up is kind of like a little mental shortcut to all the connections that are involved with that word. Or you'll type a phrase in, or you'll type get an image for something to kind of help you visualize something. I try not to rely on it as a crutch too much, but I'd be lying if I didn't tell you that I usually had a browser open to put in a couple of errant thoughts just to see the return on them. Also to see, like sometimes you come up with a joke and it's like, nah, that's really obvious. I bet you it's been done 100 times, and you can kind of see whether you're right or wrong on that, maybe talk you out of not doing something that was less well-trod earth than you thought it was. But yeah,
right.
I like to be alone and completely sheltered.
So mine, since you asked so kindly, so my conditions are, and thank you for asking, my conditions are I'm also alone. I've had 2, possibly 3 coffees, like a little too much, mm-hmm, basically, and I'm jittery. But the best situation from that, though, is that the previous night I've hung out with the funniest people that I know.
Yeah.
So I'm alone by myself. I've got a bunch of coffee in me. But the night before, the conversation was crackling and my mind was firing on all pistons. Because there's something about conversation with the funniest people you know that makes my writing process so much easier the next day.
Well, and you know why that is, I think? I'm gonna pontificate on that. Because when you make a funny person laugh, it's a confidence builder. If I make you laugh, I feel good about myself because you are somebody who I consider to have a great sense of humor. If I can, and as a result, like if I tell you a joke, you've been working on humor for such a long time, you probably guessed the punchline by the time I get there. But if I can get you to laugh, if I can really surprise you, if I can pull something out of my hat, that makes me feel good about myself. And I will go to my grave saying that 80% of writing is confidence.
Yeah, yeah. Well, and a true surprise too, not well-trodden passive humor, but true surprise.
Yeah.
And what I mean by that is I'm going to compare it to running. So if I'm trying to make my least funny aunt laugh, I can kind of jog it in, you know, like, well, that's why dogs are blankety blank and I'll get a delightful little chuckle and a slice of lemon cake,
right.
You know, that kind of thing.
Right.
But if I'm trying to make the four or five funniest people that I know laugh, I know I have to be on my A game. I have to be sprinting, not jogging, sprinting. And I have to be finding connections and parallels that are truly surprising in terms of humor.
Yeah.
I can't go down well-trodden paths. I can't use a joke that literally everyone in that room could have thought of. It has to be able to surprise them all. And so I think basically your brain, your neurons are truly firing. Your chemical levels are up in your brain. And you're working at your best. And so the next day when you go to sit down to write after a night out with the funniest people you know, you are all those pathways are still kind of activated a little bit. And you're remembering, you have a muscle memory of what it was to make the funniest people you know laugh. And so that's my ideal condition. Like if I can hang out with friends that are in Groundlings or UCB or professional comedians, that kind of thing. And then the next day, write, oh boy,
yeah.
I feel like I'm at the top of my game.
And it's not like like you said, you had to be mentally sprinting. It's not like it's a chore. It's not like, oh God, I can't believe I can't keep up with these people. It's kind of a joy, or maybe it should be a joy. In other words, it's something that you should absolutely embrace, this challenge of keeping up with people who are a little bit, maybe in my case, maybe a little bit smarter, maybe a little bit funnier than you. It's a challenge to keep up with them.
Right. There is something there's something to the fact that you want to be hanging around with your betters, basically. That's a great point. They're not going to fall for your easy B jokes because they're at their A game. And so you better bring your A game if you're even going to try to make them laugh. Yes, that's exactly true.
Here's another one that I do that you were saying, read something. And for me, it's going to be different for everybody. But for me, I will watch a Mel Brooks movie specifically because what's wonderful about Mel Brooks is that he doesn't take himself so seriously. So there's a lot of stuff that's pure delight in Mel Brooks that is very silly and very dumb and not very sophisticated, but it's devastatingly funny. And some of that is because of how he executes it, which is another great topic, the execution of humor. But sometimes I watch Mel Brooks just to remind myself that it doesn't have to be arduous. It doesn't have to be intellectual. Sometimes it can just be a pie in the face. Sometimes it can just be silly.
When there's joy in hanging out with truly funny people, I am not a dancer, I'm not a singer, but when five or six people are truly crackling with humor, to me, that must be what the joy of being in a choir is like, or being in a room of dancers. When there's a flow, there's a rhythm, everything is working together. People are building, people are yes-anding. And so there is, like you said, there's a joy, a simple joy in it, and it's not arduous. It's the process itself is fun. And so coming off a night like that and then writing, that's the best for me. So the problem there is, like, as the questioner might be asking now, is like, well, that's great. I can't every night hang out with the cast of SNL. How do I get that at home? And the answer, like you just said, is you watch Mel Brooks or you read A Hitchhiker's Guide or you find comedy that works for you, that gets that crackling spirit and that joy going, and then you write. It's a great way to do it.
And don't forget, the most powerful thing you've got is your life and your experiences. And I always, always, always recommend, especially to young people who are starting out, to, and it's the oldest advice in the world, carry a notebook, keep a diary. right? So you should have something around. And, you know, if it's your iPhone, it's your iPhone, you know, something to take a note in so that when you do have that momentary flash of brilliance, you can preserve it. Or just a random thought, just something that you can tell when it enters your brain. Ah, this is something. It's not something right now, but it's got the potential to be something.
Oh, Brad, that's a great point. That is a great point.
And then don't forget your diary. It take 5 minutes at the end of the night and write down a bunch of the stuff that happened to you. It's not going to be anything today. But when you look back on it a month from now or a year from now, and you have a completely different headspace and a completely different set of things that are entering and exiting your brain, you're going to see all kinds of things that happened in your own life that opens up the door for all kinds of humor. Don't disrespect your life. Don't disrespect your experiences. It's the funniest stuff you got anyway. What does everybody tell you? Write what you know. Well, the problem is you forgot what you knew because you didn't write it down. You think, oh, I'm always going to remember what I was doing on Tuesday, March 43rd.
March. Wow. Wow.
Jeez, I cannot think this fast. I'm always going to, you know what I mean. I'm always going to remember March 3rd.
You'll forget what you were doing on Tuesday, March 43rd. That's a month, isn't it? Oh, Brad.
Holy cow. I was on such a roll, too. Well, you know what I'm trying to say.
I get it.
You got to write this stuff down and then go back and review it every now and again. You'll find all kinds of gems there that you didn't know was happening at the time.
That's fascinating. I did not know that you were a diarist. I have tried and never succeeded in being a diarist. I lose patience for it. I don't give a shit for it. I'm bored with my own diary entries, both current and past, and I always give up. So I'm fascinated that you do that.
Yeah, it's something that I've had varying degrees of success, if I'm being completely honest. But it's something I believe in strongly.
Yeah, I mean, I've always appreciated that line of the unexamined life is not one worth living. But for me, diarying has never been the source of that. I've never enjoyed the process or the result of that. So I'm fascinated to hear that you do that. That's interesting.
I'm wondering how you could incorporate that into your life. I mean, you keep a calendar, right? Like one of those desk calendars or like a little book?
Yes. I wonder if it's for the most part that I don't, how do I say this in a way that sounds false, not sound falsely humble. I don't care about my own life enough.
Yeah.
And so I don't find it that interesting what I did today or who, I don't know. I don't know how to say it in a way that doesn't sound mean-spirited about my own life, but I don't, I wish I cared more about it, but I don't, I don't know who I'm writing that for. Am I writing it for future me? Well, future present me doesn't want to read about past me, so why would future me want to read about present me? Like I don't give a shit what five years ago me thought about this or that, so why would future me care what I think right now? I don't know. It's an interesting psychological difference between you and I that you find benefit in that, to which and I value that, but it, for whatever reason, it never worked for me. Mm. Because I've done, I don't know if you've, have you ever gotten roped in with a bunch of artist friends and done the artist way? Have you ever done that thing?
No.
Oh, so I did it most recently about 10 or 15 years ago. It was before we started having kids. So it was about 10, 15 years ago, and did it with a bunch of actors and writers and comedian friends in LA. And it's a whole book. I don't know that I would recommend it, but it might work for certain people. But the idea is that you try different ways of tapping into your creativity and your flow. And one of them is by diarying. I don't know how you say that in a present tense, but
journaling.
Journaling. Thank you. God, that was sounding terrible. Diarying. That's about one syllable away from disaster is what that was. Anyway, the artist way, it's 25 years old at this point, and it would be interesting to see in Patreon and Discord comments who that has worked for, because I often feel like the artist way works really well for a 50-year-old who just never found their way, and they got into a corporate job, and now they want to go back to making bracelets. Like I feel like, I don't know that the artist way works for what I do or how I do it, but in all honesty, more power to someone for whom it works for. But anyway, that was a zero endorsement from Dave Kellett about the artist way. Good job, Dave. Way to shit on the artist.
We will not have a link to that in the Patreon.
Anyway,
we'll have a link to the book, but it'll lead you someplace else.
Well, that was about a 20-minute longer answer than that person wanted about how we write through tough periods. But anyway, there we go.
Well, listen, as long as we're talking here, we've got a little bit of time. So let's talk about something that probably a lot of us either should be doing or are doing, putting together submissions for the Eisner Awards and for awards in general. Are you putting together a package for the Eisners?
Yes. So depending on when this podcast goes out, the Eisner, the deadline might have already passed. They have to be in hand by March 16th. But hopefully, if we get this out beforehand, there might be a day or two left to get your digital submissions in for the show. But it, actually, Brad, I'm kind of fascinated to talk to you about this because the Eisners obviously have grown out of a comic book tradition. So the Reuben Award grew out of the comic strip tradition. The Eisner Award grew out of the comic book tradition. And what are the other ones? The Harveys grew out of a lesser comic book tradition. I don't know what that was.
Well, and we're still waiting to see if the Harveys are going to come back.
Yeah, they're kind of gone. I was trying to think of what other comic awards there are out there. But anyway, so the Eisners, the Rubens. Anyway, the Eisners, having grown out of a comic book tradition, they are pretty specifically geared towards comic books and the comic book format and the comic book style of writing, mm-hmm. right? So if you're a New Yorker cartoonist, it's not really going to work for you aside from a book that you might have done. And if you're an editorial cartoonist, it's definitely not going to work for you. But if you have anything akin to a story form comic or a graphic novel or a comic book, then the Eisners are definitely for you. But here is my question for you, Brad. They've tried to start incorporating more and more webcomics and digital comics into the Eisner categories. And this year, the delineation is best webcomic, but it has to be a long form comic. It has to be a story. Mm-hmm. And then the other mm-hmm. one is best digital comic. So knowing nothing else about the categories, because frankly, they don't write what the categories are, what do you think the distinguishing mark is between best story form webcomic and best digital comic? Is it just ebook form? Is that what that is?
That's exactly what my answer is.
Oh, darn it. I stepped on your feet. I apologize.
I think best digital comic is like an ebook or an e-comic. It's something that you might sell on Gumroad or through Comixology. It is a something you'd read on your tablet, page after page after page, and then you're done. Whereas a long form webcomic is something that we are more familiar with, where you may be updating it on a site one page at a time. And it's more of a update by update thing that you do on a site. You might build an ebook or an e-comic out of your webcomic and then enter it into digital comic. But the way I'm reading that is that best digital comic is an e-comic and best web comic is a traditional web comic.
Okay, I think that's a fair reading. So then my next question to you is, and in some respects, it's kind of ineffable, like how will we know what they're doing? But why would they make that distinguishing mark? Is it, in their mind, is it the means of production are different enough that it warrants a different award?
I would bet that would be the case. And to be honest with you, I think that they're right. In other words, I read an awful lot of comics now that I've got an iPad, and it is a much different reading experience, especially if you've got some entity or someone that did a really good job on the panel by panel progression.
Like the Comixology stuff?
Exactly. It's really neat. You know, it can be a completely different reading experience. And to be fair, the publishing experience, the reading experience, the business that brings it to your tablet is very different between a digital comic and a web comic. So I think it's fair that they have to. In other words, I wouldn't want my Evil Inc. web comic to compete with a comic that was built to be read on an iPad as a standalone e-comic. Those are two very different
okay.
things.
That's a fair read on that. So then my third question to you is, this is me just coming to Brad for answers today. My third question to you about the Eisners is, for best webcomic, now granted they're coming out of the Eisner tradition, which is a comic book tradition, but why do you think they have so clearly delineated against short form comics in webcomics?
That kills me. And I don't know why. I really don't. And it's something that they've done. In the beginning, we were all excited when Eisner added a webcomics division, because it was a big thing for guys like us. And the fact that they hold on to that long form thing really bugs me. And I don't know whether they just don't want to deal with a short form comic or a comic strip or a comic panel. I don't know what their thoughts are on that, but it bugs me. And I wish they would stop it. I wish they would just say it's a webcomic and we will judge it on its own merits as a webcomic. I don't know why. I'd love to see them come around.
Well, and I think the reason why it bothers me, and not on a personal level, but more on a genre level, is that I think some of the best work in webcomics, at least for the first decade of webcomics, was being done in short form.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, there are, don't get me wrong, there are amazing, I do it myself, there are amazing long-form comics in webcomics, but the fact that that gets removed entirely from the process, I mean, you're losing 60, 70, 80 cartoonists who are among the best going right now in webcomics by not allowing short-form in there or allowing for a separate category.
Yeah, it doesn't make any sense. Like I said, I'm thrilled they do it, but I am not thrilled with that particular aspect.
And now I know that the Eisners allows the judges, did you know this, that they allow the judges to create their own categories if they don't see something representative in the categories that were presented to them? Did you know that that is possible?
Really?
Here's my critique of that, though. The judges are always like, Jimmy Palatino, I own Dragons and Lances in Poughkeepsie, and I never opened a computer. I'm completely Iron Man fan. I've owned my own shop. Like, he's not going to give a shit about what John Allison is doing right now. Like, he's never read a webcomic. So that guy, if there's three judges that own a comic book shop or they come out of the comic book tradition, they just don't care enough about webcomics because it's not on their radar, you know?
No, I agree with you 100%.
It's like you saying, hey, Dave, what Dragon Ball Z categories you want this year? It's just not on my radar.
So listen, Dave, let's say that I had a magic wand to grant you one wish.
Oh, here we go. All right.
Would you rather win an Eisner, a Harvey, an NCS Division Award, or an Ignatz? Which do you value the most?
Wow. Okay. So the answer is, in my 20s and 30s, I wanted nothing more than to start winning awards. And don't get me wrong, I still, I would love to win that Eisner. But
yeah.
I have come to realize that it doesn't change your career one whit to win an award, having won one of them, and that you go back the next morning to being the same somewhat insecure cartoonist that you were the night before when you won. So having said that, though, I sure would love to win an Eisner at this point.
What is it about the Eisner Award? Because I feel the same way. It'd be great to win any of them, but it'd be extra great to win an Eisner. And I don't know why that is. Is it because it's one of the oldest ones? I don't know.
I don't know. I feel like, so the NCS Division Award, which I won, it's still not the same as the Big Reuben. I would love to win the Big Reuben when I'm 60 or 70. That would be lovely. But at that point, I'm a foot in the grave anyway. And so it'll just be like, oh, look, I did good work 40 years ago. It'll be that kind of stage in my life, you know?
At that point, you're winning an award because you haven't died yet.
Yes, that's exactly what that award is.
Congratulations. And the Still Breathing Award goes to Dave Kellett.
Took care of that prostate problem. Good job. He's still alive.
The bad news is that it comes as such a shock that it kills you, and then they have to take the award back.
Oh, God. Yes. The Big Reuben would be nice, but what's funny is about it physically is that do you know that the Reuben is the biggest and heaviest award going? Like, it's heavier than the Oscars, heavier than the Grammys and the Emmys.
Really?
Gigantic.
What's it made out of?
Out of like a thousand dead cannons from the Civil War. I don't know. It was like 100 pounds. It's cast iron I think it's cast iron, maybe it's brass, but it's if you look at it online, it's a huge sculpted figure that's about 2 feet tall.
That's right. It's a Rube Goldberg, like figures that are stacked on
top
of each
other. Yes, they're all
naked
and they're stacked on top of each other. And then if you look at an Eisner, it looks like best participation award for a junior soccer league, you know? Like, you know the ones that your kids got when you were hey, you also were in this soccer league and you got the
they just have a big box of them over by the side of the field and they're just handing them to anybody that's walking by.
Yeah, and it says participant on it, you know, that kind of thing. Like an Eisner, it's like a square base and a round ball. It's exactly like a participant award for a soccer trophy. It doesn't look like much. And yet, I would love to win one of those at some point in my life. But the thing is, though, too, I have somewhat come to peace with the fact that I don't know that I will ever be enough on the radar of Jimmy Palmiotti, who owns Dragons and Lances in Poughkeepsie.
By the way, you do know that there is a real Jimmy Palmiotti, right?
What,
and he's an artist that that works for, has done tons of work for like Marvel and DC. And his wife, Amanda Connor, is best known for like Power Girl, and they do a bunch of stuff together.
That's amazing. No, I just grabbed the name.
There is a Jimmy Palmiotti. And actually, I got to say, he's a very nice guy. Well, then, but he doesn't own any retail stores.
My apologies to Jimmy for accidentally grabbing a word out of my brain, and it was his name. I apologize. How about Timmy Benedetti, who there?
There you go. Anyway.
I was just looking for a representative sample of a guy that owns a comic book shop that doesn't know Drive from Evil Inc., from Bobbins, from Penny Arcade, from the Oatmeal. You know, like just like if it's not Iron Man number 238, then they don't know what it is. You know, and so I've come to peace with the fact that even though I've been nominated twice for an Eisner, that's never going to happen because I just don't think I live in that world enough that they would even care or know who I am. So,
no, I agree with you. And maybe that's what makes it so wantable, makes it something that you want so much, because you know that it actually getting it is a real, real long shot.
Yes, yes. It's like, okay, this is like another thing on my bucket list, is that at some point, you're going to laugh at this one. At some point, I want to be recognized for my comics by the French, because somehow if I've jumped over the pond.
By the French.
Because here's my weird twisted thinking about this. If somehow my career has done as well where even the French notice me, then by God, I did all right before I died. I had a good career. And then the super leap on that is you not only get recognized by the French comics market, but you get honored by the Japanese comics market, because then you've super leveled up, because the Japanese are such a cloistered, well-developed market that they don't need to read American comics that are, you know, second rate. They've got a beautiful market on their own. So
I think I would value the Japanese approval more than the French. Maybe a little bit more.
Did you say the fresh? I think you said the fresh.
I've been having trouble making words happen all day long.
I gotta tell you, Charlotte, you're having some trouble with the fresh.
Oh,
no, but
God.
So you would value a Japanese affirmation more than French affirmation.
Yeah. Yeah.
But isn't that interesting? There's a tiny part of your brain that actually you're like, no, I see that would be an affirmation. That would feel great in my career.
Without a doubt. Well, here's my question, Dave. When's Angoulême?
Angoulême is usually in the first or second or third week of January. It's in the, and thankfully, it's in the coldest months of France. And oh, you know what? I have to say that was nice in my career when Fred Schroeder and I got invited over to Angoulême to show Stripped. And boy, that felt like the closest I'll ever get to French affirmation of my work. That was nice.
No, that's one of my goals. Not necessarily to table or anything like that, but just to go and enjoy that festival, I think would be wonderful.
Oh my God. Angoulême is like nothing you've ever experienced in American comics. And if you happen to be an American living in Europe, or studying in Europe at the next year or two, go to Angoulême. And if you are a European who has easy access by a bullet train down to Angoulême, go. It's an amazing show. I can't recommend it enough. Fred and I had a lovely 4 days there, and we ate like pigs, and we drank like the gluttons of old, and it was a delightful time in France.
Well, maybe we'll set that as a goal. When we get 1,000 ratings on iTunes, you and I will make a trip out of it and go to Angoulême.
Well, we'll have to make some more money because it ain't a cheap trip. That's
Well, where do you think those 1,000 ratings are coming from?
I hope they're coming from Bill Gates, because that flight don't pay for it.
Well, on that note, you've been listening to Comic Lab, the show about making comics and making a living through comics.
Your hosts have been Charlotte, the editor of webcomics.com. And cartoonist of Evil Inc. at evil-comic.com.
And Dave Kellett, the co-director of Stripped and the cartoonist of Sheldon at sheldoncomics.com and Drive at drivecomic.com.
And the Comic Lab theme song is used with permission from Andy Creighton at theworldrecord.net.
Comic Lab is made possible by your support on patreon.com/comiclab. So we'll go ahead and say that twice. patreon.com/comiclab.